Hello students, as we reach the last module of signals and system, it is very important for you to understand like the whole picture of signals and system and right now where we are. In the first module, we defined what the signal and system is. So based on that, we had continuous time signal and system and discrete time signal and system, which we used to represent as where the continuous time signal is represented by x of t being the input of the system, h of t being the impulse response of the system or the system itself, and y of t is considered as the output signal of the system. So when we give an input to a system which is represented by the impulse response h of t, we get an output. Similarly, in the case of discrete time signal, x of n is considered as the input of the system and y of n is considered as the output of the system, which we get when we pass x of n through the impulse response h of n of the system. So all of this we studied in the first module. Then we moved on to define the frequency domain, the frequency domain of the continuous time signal, wherein for periodic signal we defined what is known as the Fourier series. And non-periodic, we defined what was the Fourier transform. This was the second module. And as I wrote the color black, as I wrote it in color black, frequency domain of continuous time signals and the system. And from that, we came to know, especially from Fourier transform, that x of t can be represented as x of omega. The impulse response can now be represented as capital H of omega, and y of t can be represented as capital Y of omega, where this is again the input, this is the output, and this is the transfer function of the system. H of omega is called as the transfer function of the system. And what is the main thing that we understood was that in continuous time signal, or in continuous time case, where we had to find out the output by using the only formula as the convolution between x of t with the system h of t, in here we can find out by using the formula that y of omega is going to be equal to x of omega into h of omega. So the convolution, which was a little bit complex mathematics, turned out to be a simple mathematics because of the multiplication in the frequency domain. That was one of the advantages we saw of the frequency domain. So this is the second module. Now coming to the third module. In the third module, which is again of the continuous time signal, we have the Laplace transform. We have the Laplace transform of the continuous time signal. Okay. And in Laplace transform, what we saw was that we converted x of t as capital X of s. The system got converted to capital H of s, and y of omega got converted to capital Y of S. Again, this was the input, this was the output, and this was the transfer function. And we can very easily find out that the output Y of S will be equal to X of S multiplied with H of S. So we can find out any one of the three if we know the other two. Okay. The Laplace transform was basically taking the signal to the S domain. And the second half of the third module, we went to what is called as the sampling theorem, wherein we sample the continuous time signal. So we take the continuous time signal, we sample it, and we get the discrete time signal. So now we are slowly moving from continuous time signal to discrete time signal. That is again module 4. So from there, module 3. So from there we move to module 4, which is for discrete time signal. So now for discrete time signal, what we have is again the frequency domain of not the continuous time but the discrete time signal and its system. And just like we had for the case of periodic, the Fourier series, here also we had discrete time Fourier series, and for non-periodic we had the discrete time Fourier transform. Now the signal X of n got converted to capital X of omega, system got converted to capital H of omega, and Y of n got converted to capital Y of omega, where this was the input of the system, this was the system which is now called as the transfer function of the system, and Y of omega is the output of the system. And just like in here, in the case of discrete time also, where the output Y of n was considered to be the convolution sum of X of n with H of n, here we are having that Y of omega should be a multiple of X of omega multiplied with capital H of omega. You should take care that for discrete case we are putting the square brackets. So you can see parallelly we have defined for continuous time signal and discrete time signal. Now we are coming to the fifth module, which is in parallel to the Laplace transform of continuous time signal. So here in fifth module we are having what is called as the Z transform. So Z transform is similar to Laplace transform continuous time, and here we are having for discrete time signal. And just like in Laplace, here we will have the X of Z as the input, the transfer function will be H of Z, and the output will be capital Y of Z. Okay, where X of Z is the input, Y of Z is the output, H of Z is the transfer function. Now if you would remember, in the case of Laplace transform, we had discussed what was something called as the region of convergence, wherein we used to define a stable system, a causal system, isn't it? Just like that, in Z transform also, we will define using the region of convergence that is there in the Z transform to define the system stability and causality. So this is what the whole signals and system your subject is looking like. You can see I have drawn the continuous time signal things in black, and In the other color, the magenta color, I have drawn for the case of discrete time signal and which all modules are there. So this is the whole big picture and what you have to study in this particular subject. Okay, so let us move to Z transform. As it is shown here, the bilateral or two-dimensional or two-sided Z transform of a discrete time signal or sequence of a discrete time signal x of n is given by the equation that is given here, where you can see we are having summation minus infinity to infinity x of n, and now we are having z raised to power minus n, where you know in previously we had e raised to power minus j omega n for the case of the discrete time Fourier transform, that is DTFT. Now instead of that we are having z raised to power minus n, where we are considering that z is a complex variable and the complex variable is represented in polar form, that means r e raised to power j omega. So that r e raised to power j omega is written in short as z, and we are considering this to be a z transform equation. And what I want you to remember here is that z is a complex variable which is having a magnitude r and a phase omega. So if I am trying to draw the z will be drawn in a complex plane itself, which has a real axis as well as an imaginary axis, but now it is represented in polar format, where the length of is now r, and phase angle omega is the angle that the polar coordinate makes with the real axis. What I would like to remind you that in Laplace transform we had what was called as the S plane, and the S plane was basically defined with respect to sigma plus j omega, where we used to draw the S plane again with sigma and j omega. But now instead of drawing the polar, we used to always draw the rectangular coordinates, that is the real part and the imaginary part. Okay, whereas in case of Z transform it is in polar form, that is the only difference. So Z plane and S plane are similarly looking. Now this was for the case of two-sided or bilateral Z transform, where n was going from minus infinity all the way up to plus infinity. But when we are talking about a unilateral Z transform, which is one-sided, we define it from 0, we define it from 0 all the way up to infinity. We define it from 0 all the way up to infinity. And that is how a unilateral Z transform is. The basic difference is one takes care of the whole n axis, that means the negative as well as positive axis, whereas this is only for the case of n positive axis, or what we can call as the causal part of the whole system. Okay, so only for 0 to infinity. What are the advantages of Z transform? The advantages of Z transform is that it basically converts a difference equation of a discrete time signal into a linear algebraic equation, so that the analysis becomes easy. That means we know that sometimes the system is represented by a simple equation, wherein in this side you are having the input x of n plus something into x of n minus 1 plus something into x of n minus 2, like that, is equal to y of n into some b into y of n minus 1 plus something into y of n minus 2, like that. So this is basically called as a difference equation. To solve this and find out h of n, it is quite difficult. Okay, it is quite difficult to solve this equation and find out h of n from this equation of input and output. Whereas you know, we can find this answer very easily with the help of the Z transform by converting this difference equation that we see here into Z transform equation, and that will change that equation into a linear algebraic equation, because of which the analysis will become easy. We will see it later after we study Z transform. Next, the convolution in time domain is very easily converted to multiplication in the frequency domain. Okay, now why I'm saying frequency domain, because the Z domain is again e raised to power j omega, so again it is called as a frequency domain. Okay, and similarly the Z transform exists for most of the signal for which the DTFT analysis cannot be done, because if you remember this first advantage that we see here, this can be done in DTFT, this also can be done in DTFT, but there are many signals for which the DTFT does not exist, and for such cases the Z transform will exist, and that is why we are studying Z transform also. Now we will start with some of the common sequences Z transform. We'll first start with unit sample sequence. Unit sample signal is a signal which has a value of 1, that means delta is equal to 1 only for n is equal to 0. For all other values its value is 0. So if I am going to try to find out the Z transform of delta n using this particular equation that I am having, this particular equation, then I will substitute, instead of x of n, I will substitute delta of n. If I substitute delta of n, then the equation basically looks like this. But we know that delta of n exists for only n is equal to 0. So the summation, there is no point. We will try to find only at n is equal to 0. And if I would try to find at n is equal to 0, I substitute the value of n is equal to 0. So z raised to power 0 is again 1. So e raised to delta omega, okay, delta, the impulse unit sample sequence, delta at 0 is again 1, so 1 into 1 is going to be 1, and with that we can say that the unit sample sequence delta n is basically going to give me a Z transform of 1, which we basically write it in this particular format, that delta n gives a Z transform of 1. Now I have written here for all Z. What does that mean? That you will understand when you look at the next question. For delta, for any value of Z, we will get the value of delta n is equal to 1. For any value of Z means for any value of r e raised to power j omega, the value of delta n is going to be equal to 1. Next is the unit step sequence. X of n is equal to u of n. We know that u of n is having a value of 1 for all values of n positive, which we write it like this equation that we are having here. And based on that, what we can say is that the signal will exist only for positive values of n. Now putting it in the Z equation, Z transform equation, to find out the value of Z transform, instead of x of n I will substitute u of n, and we all know that u of n exists only for n is equal to 0 to infinity, so I have changed the summation from 0 to infinity, the value of u of n is equal to 1, so I have not written that 1 here. Then rest is z raised to power minus n, where I can take that n as common, not common, I can take that n as a power for z raised to power minus 1. So we know that z raised to power minus 1, the whole raised to n, is simply multiplication of minus 1 into n, which will give me z raised to power minus n. Now how do we solve this? We have seen the equation, the summation equation, if you remember, that summation of any alpha raised to power n from 0 to infinity will give me an answer 1 divided by 1 minus alpha. This is an equation we have already seen at the time of DTFT, which we have extensively used. But here the condition is that the value of alpha should be less than 1, otherwise this equation can't be followed. So here also, if we are going to apply the same equation, then the answer will be 1 divided by 1 minus z inverse. But with the condition that we have seen here, the same condition we will apply, and that is that the z inverse should be less than 1. Where, if I am going to write this, you know, if I am going to write this, you please look here. If I am going to write z inverse can be written as 1 by z less than 1. Or if I take z the other side, it will come as z is greater than 1. Okay, z is going to be greater than 1. So the z transform of u of n can be written as 1 divided by 1 minus z inverse, which we have got here. Or if I am going to put z inverse as 1 by z here, then you can see that the denominator, in the numerator we will get a z, and in the denominator we will get z minus 1. Okay, how? So here we are having that u of n will give a z transform of this or this equation. See, what we have to look here is I am writing two answers, and both this you have to remember, because you know the answer may come in any of the form, either in z form or in z inverse form. You will understand it later. Okay, so we will try to remember both these equation, and the region of convergence is for z greater than 1. That is what we have done here is we have drawn the z plane, which is basically, you know, the imaginary and the real part of the complex equation. We have drawn it as two different axes, okay, the real and the imaginary, so sigma and j omega. But now instead of drawing it as a rectangular coordinate, we have drawn as a polar coordinate, and we have drawn z for z is equal to 1. Up to z is equal to 1, it is not possible, but only for value of z greater than 1. So we have drawn a circle of radius 1, and you can see that this circle is dotted circle. Please remember that we have drawn a dotted circle. You cannot draw a solid circle, because a solid circle means that you are including 1. That means you are talking of z greater than or equal to 1. But we are not having greater than or equal to, we are only considering greater than. So you need to draw only a dotted circle. So outside the dotted circle, we have shaded this, and to mean that the equation will converge only for these values, the shaded region values, which is for z greater than 1. That's why we have called the ROC, or the region of convergence is greater than 1, and that is what the equation is. Next, we will look into the unit ramp sequence. The unit ramp sequence is basically n u of n. That means for n greater than 0 or positive values of n, we are having the value of r of n to be n. Okay, now with that we are going to substitute in the z transform equation u of n, where u of n exists only for 0 to infinity. So the limit is now changing, the summation limit has now changed to n 0 to infinity. Value of u of n is equal to 1, and what we are having is this equation. Now again, in the summation equation we have seen that for any value of alpha, the summation of n alpha raised to power n for the limits 0 to infinity can be written as this equation, that is alpha divided by 1 minus alpha the whole square, provided that the magnitude of alpha is less than 1. So if I am going to apply the same concept here, alpha is going to be z inverse, and applying the same equation, I will get, instead of alpha, so I will write alpha z inverse divided by 1 minus z inverse the whole square, where z inverse, if I write it as 1 by z, you can see that here it will become z minus 1 the whole divided by z. That I can take on top, but since this is square, what we will have is 1 divided by we will have only a z at the top. So that is what we have done here. So as you can see, this z, that is when it is taken to numerator, it is z square. So z square into 1 by z will give me only z. Okay, but for the condition that z inverse should be less than 1, or as I previously told, z inverse can be written as 1 by z less than 1 can be as such good written as z being greater than 1. Okay, so the z transform of n u n will be either this equation or the solved part of that equation, which is this equation. Again, you can see in this equation it is z inverse, whereas here it is only in terms of z. Okay, for a region of convergence z greater than 1, z greater than 1, again if I am to draw this region of convergence, I will draw a dotted signal, not dotted circle of 1, and I will shade the region outside of that. I will shade the region outside of the circle 1. Okay, so that is the z transform of n u of n. Next, we look into the exponential sequence of xn is equal to e raised to power minus j omega n u of n. Again, since it is u of n, the limit will change from minus infinity to infinity. It will change to 0 to infinity because of this u of n, and u of n will become 1. So only dot remains as e raised to power minus j omega n z raised to power minus n, where I can take n as a common power term. So what I am having now is this factor for alpha, that means alpha raised to power n. Again, I will use the equation that I have previously used, that is n is equal to 0 to infinity alpha raised to power n will give me an answer 1 divided by 1 minus alpha, provided that alpha magnitude is less than 1. So here, if I am going to consider whatever is inside the bracket as alpha, then I can write this as 1 divided by, I can write the answer as 1 divided by 1 minus e raised to power minus j omega z inverse, where again z inverse, if I write it as 1 by z, then z can come here as well as in the numerator, and I will get the answer as z divided by z minus e raised to power minus omega. But we have to take this condition, that is the magnitude of alpha should be less than 1, which when we apply here, it will be this. Now tell me, what is the magnitude of e raised to power minus j omega? The magnitude of that is 1, isn't it? So it is as good as writing 1 into the magnitude of z inverse. Okay, so that is why when it came here, that e raised to power minus j omega term is not to be seen, and we can write that z inverse is less than 1, which gets converted as z is greater than 1, the region of convergence. We will get the z transform of the exponential term to be this or this, if the region of convergence is considered to be z greater than 1. Again, what we have to draw is, we have to draw a circle, a dotted circle of having a radius of 1, and try to shade the region outside of that. Okay, now in similar lines, instead of minus j omega, I can write this as plus j omega. I can write this as plus j omega, and I can follow the same equation. I will get the answer as it is shown here, as it is shown here, instead of e raised to power minus j omega, I am having just plus j omega. That is the only difference. Okay, rest all things remain the same. Now using these two results, we can find out for the case of sine and cosine. How? You know, sine can be split up as using the Euler's relation as e raised to power j omega n minus e raised to power minus j omega n divided by 2j, where u and I will split it up apart, and then this into u and I will take as one of the z transform that I want to take, and similarly this into this u of n I will take it as a second z transform that I have to take. But just now we have found out that, isn't it? Just now we found out what is the z transform of u of n e raised to power minus j omega and u of n e raised to power j omega. So all we have to do is just substitute these answers and these region of convergences, and that is what exactly I am doing here. I am substituting the z transform value, I am substituting directly for this one, this is the answer, and for this one, this is the answer. Okay, and now I do the cross multiplication. You can do it on your own, this cross multiplication. You can pause the video, try to do it on your own and see if you are getting this answer. And again, I have, you know, joined these two parts, because here plus 1 and minus 1 will basically cancel off, whereas these two parts I will take together, and I will take the z inverse as common. So what comes out is e raised to power j omega minus e raised to power minus j omega. If I multiply this with 2j and divide this with 2j, but already there is a 2j here, so there is no need to multiply. So if I take this 2j inside, then this will get converted completely into sine omega using the Euler's relation. Similarly, here in the denominator, what we can see is e raised to power j omega, you know, e raised to power j omega plus e raised to power, I should have written here minus j omega, okay, for this one and this one. If I am going to take z inverse common, then this can be divided with 2 multiplied with 2, then this will convert into cos, and that is what we have done here. We have got 2z, we have got here 2z inverse cos omega, and obviously since the region of convergence is common for them both, so the region of convergence has come out to be for z greater than 1. So now I can write it that sine omega n u of n, the z transform will be either this equation, or I can write, instead of z inverse, I can write 1 by z. Similarly for z raised to power minus 2, I can write it as 1 by z square. Similarly here also I can write 1 by z, and if I solve it, I will get this equation. You can try it on your own. So I am having one equation which is of z inverse terms, and another equation which is of z terms, and for the region of convergence z greater than 1. Similarly, I can get for the case of cos omega n, because again using Euler's relation, the cos omega n term can be written as e raised to power j omega n plus e raised to power minus j omega n divided by 2, where I can split this apart and I can write the z transform of this function as well as z transform of this function, which we just now saw, you know, in the previous example. We have got the 2 for a region of convergence which is this. Again, you do the cross multiplication. I will leave it up to you. You can pause the video here. You can pause the video here, try to solve this, and you will see that you will get the answer of z transform as this. So now I will write the final answer, that for the case of a signal which is cosine of omega n u of n, the z transform will be this that we have just now got, where I can substitute the z inverse and the z raised to power minus 2, I can write it as 1 by z square, and again solve it to basically get this equation for the region of convergence z greater than 1. You can check it. Okay. Next, we go into a very important two very important questions, because we are trying to find out the Z transform of a right-handed sequence, and we know that the right-handed sequence can always be written as a raised to power n u of n. Okay, so first we try to find out the Z transform of a right-handed sequence and then of a left-handed sequence, and let us look at what is the comparison between them, what is the comparison of the answer between them. So if I am going to take x of n is equal to a raised to power n u of n, so I will substitute instead of x of n in the Z transform equation, but since it is u of n which is existing only from 0 to infinity, so the limit that I have put here, the summation limit, gets changed to 0 to infinity a raised to n. Instead of u of n I have written 1, which is, there is no need to write here. The common power n can be taken outside, and what we are having in the bracket is a z raised to power minus 1, which can be considered as alpha, and we already know the equation that summation 0 to infinity of alpha raised to n will be having the answer 1 by 1 minus alpha, and that will have that answer we will have only if the magnitude of alpha is less than 1. So for this equation, again, for this equation, I will have the answer as 1 divided by 1 minus a z inverse, or if I put z inverse as 1 by z, I can write that as z by z minus a, for a z inverse to be greater than, to be less than 1, which can be written as a by z magnitude to be less than 1, or z to be greater, magnitude of z to be greater than a, magnitude of z to be greater than a. So I should write magnitude of a. Okay, I should write here magnitude of a. So for such a case, we can see that for a right-handed sequence, we can see that the answer is basically given by this equation, 1 by 1 minus a z inverse, or z divided by z minus a, where a is basically the value that we are having here. Okay, but the region of convergence is z greater than magnitude of a, which means that we are talking of the shaded region outside of the circle a. Up till now we have drawn the circle to be having a value of radius 1, but now we are drawing it to have a value of radius a with the shaded region outside of a. And another thing I want you to notice is that if you would look at what are the poles and the zeros, so 0 here is z is equal to 0, but the pole is z minus a is equal to 0, or z is equal to plus a. And where is that? That can be drawn here. And where is the 0 that can be drawn? The 0 can be drawn here. So both of them are in the unshaded region. Both of them are in the unshaded region, the poles and the 0. And the shaded region is outside of that. Okay? Outside of that. Whereas when we are going for a left-handed sequence, we know the left-handed sequence, the equation is basically given by this. So for a left-handed sequence, what we are having is this equation, which we can substitute, and you can see that this limit, see, u of minus n minus 1 will be something that will be existing only in the negative axis. That means it will exist only from minus 1 all the way up to n is equal to minus infinity. So it is not a, you know, this is u of minus n will basically exist from 0 to minus infinity, but minus n minus 1 will be something that will be exist only from minus 1 to minus infinity to minus 1. Okay, and that is what we do here. So So what we are having is this particular equation, this will only be 1 for the limit minus infinity to minus 1. So up till that value we will get this. The negative is common, so the negative we can take outside. And what we can do is, if I am going to put n as minus n, if I put n is equal to minus n, then you can see that the value of minus infinity will become plus infinity, and plus 1, minus 1 will become plus 1, and a raised to power n will become a raised to power minus n, whereas z raised to power minus n will become z raised to power n. Why? Because we have put this particular condition. Here I can take the negative value outside, so the minus is outside, and whatever remains, these two, okay, that will remain inside. Now the n is equal to 1, it is starting from and going all the way up to infinity, isn't it? Why don't we make it start from 0? If I want to make it start from 0, then I will have to subtract from here what is the n is equal to 0 value. And what is at n is equal to 0? If I put the value of n is equal to 0 in this, then I will get the value as 1. So from here, from this equation, instead of starting it from 1, I will start it from 0, and I will subtract out this particular value from that. This particular value I will subtract out from that, which is minus 1. And then the equation becomes like this, where this negative that was outside, this negative that was outside is now taken into consideration. I can rearrange the equation. The equation looks something like this, where now this portion can be considered as alpha, and we have again the equation that we always use. So this will exist as 1 by 1 minus alpha only if the magnitude of alpha is less than 1, wherein if I am going to put the value, you can see that, you can pause the video, you can solve this, and you will see that this equation will come out to be 1 divided by 1 minus a z inverse for the ROC a inverse is 1 by a, so z by a should be, magnitude should be less than 1, or z should be less than, the magnitude of z should be less than magnitude of a. So if I am going to write that, then basically it means what? So you know, I will substitute the value, I will substitute the value as we have seen here using this equation. You can do it on your own, okay? You try to solve it on your own. You can pause the video, look at the video and try to solve it on your own. You will get the answer as 1 divided by 1 minus a z inverse, where you are considering this as the region of convergence, which I can write it as z by a less than 1 or z to be less than a. What is less, z less than a? Again, it's inside the circle. So first time you are getting inside the circle, and this is for the you know, left handed sequence, okay? This is for the left handed sequence. And what is this, this equation, the z transform value is coming out to be same, 1 divided by, let me write it properly, it is going to be 1 divided by 1 divided by 1 minus a z inverse, which can be written as z divided by z minus a. And for the our region of convergence, z to be less than magnitude a. So what is it that we can conclude from here? See, if you are going to have a raised to power n u of n, the z transform is going to be z divided by z minus a. Similarly, if you are going to have a left handed sequence which is minus of a raised to power n u of minus n minus 1, the z transform of that is again going to be z divided by z minus a. You can see both the left hand, the right handed sequence that we have here in the first problem, and the left-handed sequence that we are having in the second problem, both of them will give the same answer, z divided by z minus a. But where is the difference? The difference comes in the region of convergence, because when we are trying to draw the region of convergence or ROC, for this particular case, the ROC will be the circle with A as the radius. The ROC will be outside of that, will be outside of that. Whereas for the case of a left-handed sequence, the region of convergence for a, you know, value of A, if I'm going to draw the radius, then region of convergence is inside the circle. And that is what you have to remember. For the right-handed sequence, it will be outside the circle. Whereas for a left-handed sequence, it will be inside the circle. And this is the only difference. Okay. And in both the cases, the poles and the zeros will be located where the pole will be located. The zero will be located at z is equal to 0. The pole will be located here. Whereas for the second case, again, the pole will be located here and the zero will be located here. But the difference is that here both the poles and zeros are not in the region of convergence. Whereas here, the shaded region, within the shaded region, we are having the poles and the zero. So these important things you should remember, because as we move forward, these are all important. Okay. Thank you.